Hello guys, and welcome to the first episode of my new video series in which I'm going to show you all the books I recently picked up and read. So, I do not have a name for that video series yet. Any suggestions are appreciated. Feel free to comment down below. And of course, if you recognize any of the books I'm displaying in here, or if you want to know more about, one particular item in here, or you just simply have read something, comment down below and I'm going to answer to you. I'd be very willing to discuss with you in the comments, share my thoughts with you, and, communicate in a way. I think it requires some further introduction. My name is Bela, I'm from Germany, and first of all, I wanted to apologize for the way I talk. My vocabulary is limited, so sometimes it's going to be hard for me to find the right words or to use sentence structure properly. It can be that I'm desperately looking for the right words. Or another thing that kind of bothers me, a concern of me, that really annoys me at times, is that I tend to overpronounce things as soon as it gets fluent, as the words flow. Sounds pretty amateur, sounds stupid, weird, whatever. But just, you gotta deal with it. Bear with me, I'm sorry. Continuing with my history, nevertheless, I got introduced to the whole topic comics through my father. He had always been, the person in my life who was responsible for me getting into all kinds of medias, whether digital or not, books, movies, music in a way, and comic books was one of the most significant ones out of these. I grew up on titles like Asterix, Lucky Luke, Comic Boxes, Donald Duck and Uncle Scrooge, Tintin, Marvel and DC, of course, the Heavy Metal, the Epic Illustrated magazine later on, were definitely those were magnificent titles that really mean something to me today, and that I'm still with, that I'm still pretty into. But something definitely changed. Over all these years, comics have always accompanied me. The subject was always there. I always considered myself to be someone who knew more than the average guy. I had like this basic knowledge. I thought I was aware of some things that were going on, or at least about the generals, the basics. I turned out to be wrong. Just 2 years ago, that was the point where I really got passionate about things, where I started to see things differently, and where the media comic books have become a very important aspect of my life, a very important part. Since then, everything changed, my buying habits. I got aware of American publications. I know that was, one of the craziest times ever that I experienced in my life, because that whole new different world opened in front of my eyes. Something that I had never been aware of before. I hadn't realized how huge it was actually, still is, of course. And the output is enormous. The variety is enormous. Incredible. And there's never going to be enough time to check out everything. You neither have the money nor the time to check out everything, but still, I think the term that I'm looking for and that matches, or I would generalize it, I think that counts for every collector out there, for every reader maybe even, it's overwhelming. Just everything's overwhelming, and you gotta be... you gotta make decisions at first. You gotta decide what ways you wanna head, what routes you wanna head. And this is what I've done. And I, of course, go by recommendations, go by things I'm interested in. If a premise sounds appealing, I jump on the train. I'm definitely with the comic then. Alright, I think we would get into the books that I've purchased at first. And first off, it's something pretty ironic because this is a stack of single issues, as you can see, and I should have mentioned that before. I'm not really a single issues guy. I'm not collecting floppies or anything like that. It's not that I don't like the format. I do not judge people for liking it. I do like it. I think it's a very comfortable format, and it really gives you the opportunity to dive into many different areas and categories, genres, whatever. Sometimes better than an actual collected edition. But if you're already familiar with things, I would definitely recommend going for a collected edition. It's just, you know, you have everything compiled, everything. It's just in one volume, and I do like that better instead of having thousands of these. But it's very handsome, you can read it just like so. Definitely a great experience. And it's also good to fill in gaps. Some stuff has never been collected anywhere, just in issue format. So yeah, that definitely it has advantages, but I just prefer collected editions of all kinds, whether it's trades, soft covers, hard covers, super oversized special editions, whatever, even pocketbooks or such crap that many would consider crap, but I don't, for the most part. Sometimes it is when the art is really shrunken down, like in the case of Torpedo, for example, where I really think it's an insult. Sorry, CrossCult, I do like the publisher, but who? Stay me away. I want to stay away from Alex Turf being minimized like that. Always gives me, scares me. Yeah, it was pretty ironic because I bought a bunch of single issues. It's one run, Morbius the Living Vampire from the 90s. Actually, issue number 1 to issue number 28. Or with, I think, issue number 27 missing or something. So I actually got 27 issues out of, I think, 32 for not $20. Because the initial offer was $20 on eBay. And currently I consider myself to be in an eBay phase. This is just what I wanted to annotate first. In an eBay phase, you know, my buying habits change from time to time, and I'm really tracking and hunting things down on eBay. Just at the time, I really got lucky sometimes, but the problem with eBay, or a common issue that I guess most people have but not really realize, but I did eventually, it's just that you're looking for things, then if you don't get them, you get something else. There's a variety of things, of course. There are so many different products that seem appealing, but maybe, you know, if you're looking for something particular and it's just not there, of course you can be lucky. I don't say that simply there's never a chance to get the things that you're looking for, but often you find things that are cool, that are appealing to you. And you pick them eventually up, you say, okay, that's a bargain, I've got half this, it's super cheap, or you discover new things. I hadn't realized that this was something intriguing or so, but it totally sounds like, or, oh, I had this on my list before, let's give it a try. Such things. It wasn't just primarily what you're looking for. This is the case, this is something that happens to me. I cannot complain with those, with the items I got, because the price tag was too little to complain, but, you know, this is my point, and can be considered cool, can also be not. You always, as I said, you have to make decisions. Morbius the Living Vampire. What do I expect from the series? I have no idea what I expect from the series. Joke, I do. I do have some hopes, at least. I would rather consider it hopes, not expectations. I hope that it's a rather mature-oriented one. Let me just put a couple of those here, or here. A rather mature-oriented. Maybe an adult version. I do not, this is not necessarily something what you usually get from Marvel, but at least in the way it was done in the 90s, you know, with things like, okay, this doesn't belong here. In the way it was done with Todd McFarlane's Spider-Man, a revolutionary Spider-Man run that was really popular the days it came out. Todd McFarlane eventually made his own publishing house, Image Comics. I want to experience such things, because what I always found interesting about Morbius, I got to know him in the Spider-Man the Animated Series, the cartoon series from the 90s, that I still consider to be one of the best ones I've ever seen. In my life, so if you haven't checked it out, definitely go for it. It's worth it. I got introduced to the Rogues Gallery of Spider-Man. That really was magnificent. That's actually the first issue. I don't know why, you know. I've recorded that video previously, and things just got into a weird order, I call it. Morbius, what I liked about the character is where, not his pig nose, but, you know, I liked his moral conflicts and that he always had to deal with, and also that he drew the connection between Spider-Man and Blade. Spider-Man had always been the meeting point of so many different superheroes and villains. That was really astounding. And Morbius really did it for me. He was a fantastic villain. I was interested in an enemy for, you know, a great enemy for Spider-Man, just as he was facing dark times, and I wanted to get more of him anyway. So this series seems to be great, and I think because of those moral conflicts and stuff like that, that is could also be considered to be an anti-hero. I think this makes some good material. This is how he can work as both a protagonist and an antagonist. So I've also seen, for example, just random fact right now, I know it comes out of nowhere, but Ghost Rider makes a brief appearance, or maybe even more. And I really do dig the character. As you can see, this is the art style. I hope you can see something and it doesn't focus on it too much, and then I'm out of focus eventually. The camera's just too far away that you can really spot what I'm showing, I guess. Maybe I'm going to improve that in the future episodes. Here's, for example, a crossover with Spider-Man, just what you would expect. A great little ad for an X-Men board game. It's definitely something that I want to check out. Morbius versus... context, yeah. Morbius versus Spider-Man. I expect seeing it from Morbius' perspective, maybe Spider-Man even kind of being the antagonist in this one, or depicted as the villain. And I expect to see Morbius' thoughts, his, you know, his thinking processes, his motives and his opinions, that we just understand what he's doing. This is actually the first part of the crossover that I wanted to show. Okay, enough about that. I think, you know, as I said, I do not really have an opinion, a clue of what's going on in there. Anyway, it just fell down. Before we continue, I'm just gonna take a sip of my water. Because that much talking is actually making me pretty, really, dehydrated. We continue with Guardians of the Galaxy Solo Classic Omnibus. This is a really cool find. I got this off cheapcomics.com a while back, and I'm really proud of having this now. There was a time in which I really went crazy with the Marvel Omnibus line that I just had discovered. It was one of the greatest ones for me. Although many would consider these unwieldy tomes to be, I'd rather go for trades, for trade paperbacks or so. But I'm perfectly fine with those. I mean, I can understand the complaints, but I think they are mostly well regarded, just if they're so fat or so thick that the spine eventually breaks down and the binding doesn't hold it anymore. But in this case, it doesn't. And, you know, I usually read on things like desks, on surfaces where it works, so I always wonder where you are reading things that this is your complaint. I mean, just holding it in your hand, okay, then it makes sense, but do you go in bed with your comics? I mean, I do with some, but I read them in the bed, but not with such things. They would be way too valuable for me. Guardians of the Galaxy. The movie came out in 2014, and I thought it was a really brave move of Marvel doing that, because they had no idea if it was something that audiences would enjoy. They did enjoy, however, so Marvel really, they really managed it, they accomplished it to get their viewers interested. I mean, there's a sequel now, they appeared in the Infinity War, and there's going to be another sequel in MCU's Phase 4. But I had never really been interested in the comics. Although I had my fun, I enjoyed the movie. So, But I got curious, you know, the team up that we know from the big screens, Rocket, Raccoon, Star-Lord, Gamora, Groot, and so on, were created in 2008. I'm not referring to the original Guardians of the Galaxy from the 70s, I think it was the 70s with Yondu being in it from an alternate dimension. I'm referring to the one that we know from the big screens, those also being on the covers. And they were created in 2008, but this contains stars from 70s, 80s, and 90s, so I was confused. Huh? How could this possibly work out? And suddenly, the subtitle Solo Classics made sense, because this year, this tome collects the solo adventures of every individual character in here, every individual team member. Here we go. You know? Great. Still not necessarily something that would convince me, but what eventually did, what provoked me to, was the fact that the fact that this collects major issues that lead to Infinity Gauntlet and other stories by Jim Starlin, the whole space cosmos of Marvel. For example, Iron Man issue number 55, which has the first appearance of Thanos. Thanos has his debut in there. I'm just gonna, you know, try to find it very quickly to show you. I think it was actually somewhere around here. I already found it once. Here we go. Here he stands up, right facing the viewer, the reader. And yeah. Also, I love the bright colors, I love the kind of surreal Silver Age starrings, which are... Or we also got a black and white part in this, by the way. Hope you can see this. And heroes like Hulk, Iron Man, Captain Marvel, Adam Warlock, The Avengers, Marvel 2-in-1, The Thing and Spider-Man, Star-Lord, who got his own series, Zatanna, Thor, Hulk again, Rocket Raccoon, they are all featured in here, and Groot actually appeared in Tales to Astonish in the 60s for the first time, so you really see where everything started off, where it began. Okay, pulling that back in, I'm really looking forward to reading the Infinity Gauntlet storyline by Jim Starlin, and since I've watched Infinity War, really great film, by the way. I really enjoyed it. Taking another sip. Okay, continuing with something rather unusual that wouldn't have made it to my shelf, probably. Diabolik. I guess the minority of you, let's put it that way, only has heard about this. And the most of you probably don't. It's an Italian comic, those are called fumetti, and usually come in this really small format, as you can see. Pretty much similar to Dylan Dog, who's an investigator, a detective, dealing with paranormal crime activities. Great story, great thing, by the way. This one's, the German translation is slightly bigger than the Italian one, as you can see, but still rather fumetti size. Groucho Marx, for example, is a featuring character in here. I don't know if it's really claimed as such, but it's clear where they took the inspiration from. I think he's even called Groucho. Yeah, he is. Yeah. I still haven't finished my row right there. You're not able to see that anyway. But I work on it, and Diabolik is just another one of those all-time classics in Italy. Pretty much comparable to Fantomas, a great character from television and a novel character initially that I knew from my childhood, who was able to disguise as everyone he wanted to. He could just wear those face masks and then become whoever he wanted to become. And this is actually a similar premise. Once again, it's a master thief like Fantomas. And, you know, due to this very tiny format, we only got like two panels on one. page. What else can I annotate? I mean, there's one problem with those. It's the inability to read it for me. I'm not able to read it. Maybe some bits, some vocabulary from French and so on, from German, English, whatever, is going to help me understand at least a couple of words, or I can get it from the context, the pictures in here, but I don't really think this is what I'm going to do. I'm just flipping through those, and the art obviously is great. Italian art, for the most part, is incredible. It's just that I often... The issue I have with such is that they're too perfect for me. I want to see something rather, I wouldn't say innovative, but something more crazy, something more unique. Diabolik, however, is a piece of history in comics, and it's definitely worth it. You can check out other comic cultures and see what it's like. There are some German translations, but they were just unnecessarily expensive, I thought. And with such stories, would it really be necessary to get the whole package? I don't know. However, now you might consider me crazy. I went for the whole thing. This is not the only thing I picked up. Here's another stack, as you can see. Oh, just something fell down. Of Italian comics that I cannot read. I know what's going to happen with them. They're going to my shelf. And then, who knows? Maybe. You know, maybe I can, of course, do a spotlight video on those. This is something I really would like to do. But in the meantime, that you are... not getting any of this right now, check out Earl Grey's video about Dylan Dog, where he's actually also mentioned those, or Fumetti in general. Actually a pretty great colleague. And also, if you're looking for Diabolik, check out Gore Vidal's channel. I'm gonna link both of those down below. And any more recommendations of channels, just not to leave anyone out, go on my channel and you can see a variety of different recommended YouTubers that work on comics, or that work on comics, that depict, I'm getting drowsy, that display comics on YouTube. Right, continuing with, I just have to get everything straight, get everything clear. Ooh, this is something I wanted to mention later. Pretty organized here, of course, everything. So, I went to a flea market and picked up Robert Crump. This collects Fritz the Cat. I already have that collected otherwise, but still I couldn't resist. Robert Crump has some pretty whacked out art style. Really, I consider it unique sense of humor. It's underground comics. He's the father, he's the parent of underground comics. And I don't know, I think enough has been already said about him. I'm really interested in getting the new sketchbooks Taschen put out. I'm really interested in those. Since they are sold for reasonable prices. 2001 sold the original sketchbooks in Germany, and they are known, the publisher is known for today's rather rare and exclusive editions. Or at least this is what I experienced. Probably do know Crump, sold his comics on the street back then, and really invented the American underground, I would say. And then also Superman's trips, you can never go wrong with that, of course. I really don't know what time period this is. Might be 40s. I guess it is. So, shall we stay with Superman? I guess. Just doesn't make sense to really vary that much. And now I'm gonna mention the things that I do not really have much clue about. I cannot really tell you what's going on. Superman, published by Hedke, many different albums. Hedke is a German publisher known for its poor quality. You know, the pages get loose, the binding breaks, the spine breaks, and they were selling those back in the day for really expensive prices. I mean, the format in terms of size is great in my opinion, but and the cover, everything looks good, but it's really, you know, I don't know which it was, but one was already had already gotten loose pages that were falling apart. I think it was this one with stories with art by Kurt Swan, who I, by the way, really like. He's also worked with Alan Moore, I think. Oh my gosh, have you witnessed that? I have no idea where these pages belong, and I'm not gonna do that now, but this is just to give you an impression of what this what it's like. I got this offer off eBay without knowing. It was probably set somewhere, but I didn't look close enough. However, blah 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 blah. The Secret of Smallville, these were two-parters. I think they had to do something with a significant event at that time, but I'm not really sure what it was. You can see I'm not an expert when it comes to the publisher's history in universes, Marvel and DC. And The Secret of Metropolis, featuring Jimmy Olsen. Also contains art by John Byrne, some of those who I really do like. Put them down. Continuing with Vampirella, a Spanish series which also features a lot of great artists. I have read a couple of those in my youth. I mean, I'm still in my youth, but it was about those 2 years ago that I've spoken about that I started getting into comics, and I do have the most of those issues being in here collected otherwise down there, but still, I couldn't resist. This was $10 off Amazon, and I made good experiences with Amazon. I think it was Amazon Warehouse deals. This is why I took it. Black and white, of course, but powerful and really, what's kind of sad is the gutter loss. It's not too repeat. No, it's not the worst in this case, but something really gets loose, and at least you have to spread the pages out with a lot of pressure, which is not the best reading experience. At least they left the gaps in here between the panels. As you can see, it's still white in here, so not really anything of the art gets sucked in, but sometimes you have to spread out to read the beginning of a speech bubble and or to see drawings and stuff. Also, I guess it doesn't really need further talking. I plan on doing a separate video about this anyway. And once again, to mention one of our colleagues, check out Go Without's video about Spanish comics masters. He also mentions Vampirella, of course, since this is something very essential when it comes to Spanish artists. He's done a great feature on that. Ronin, which has an interesting premise, intriguing. It's done by Frank Miller, who you might know from The Dark Knight Returns or Sin City, or whatever he has done in superheroes and stuff. I personally got to know him from The Dark Knight Returns in my early childhood, and really, really liked it. It's one of my favorite. I love his rough art style. And I know many people don't, and I know that many people consider it ugly, and I can understand it part-wise. I mean, it's definitely not the most clear drawing style, but I do think it's something innovative and something unusual. Ronin is actually about a Ronin. Who would have thought so? So about a samurai whose master is dead. Or who's no longer, doesn't necessarily mean that the master's dead, but that he is no longer the pupil of the master. In this case, however, the master's dead, and 800 years have passed since the master was killed by a demon called Agat. I have no idea if that's also in the English original. Nevertheless, the premise is interesting because it's set, of course, 800 years back, and then they continue their story in the 21st century where the fight and the conflict continues, and it's still different from our 21st century, of course. It's way more high-tech. It really differs from our reality with a lot of technology. Double page spread. I also got, by the way, this bunch of... I got all of those for $2 online. If that's not a deal, what would be? The art is even more rough than in the most works I've seen. So it might really not be for everyone this time. I still do enjoy it to a certain degree, but, you know, fight sequences. And Frank Miller has these really obscure proportions. Many people have obscure proportions. Richard Corbin, Jack Kirby, in a way. But, and it always is something else. Ronin, cool premise. I'm gonna check it out. I read half of the first volume, so I can't really judge by now. Okay. I think we are almost done. No, one more thing that I've purchased, and then we get onto the books I read, which are less. So I wanna, you know, don't wanna make this video too long, although it probably already is. Batman by Doug Monk. I don't know if that's the series where Kelly Jones takes over at some time, or at least as the artist later on. The famous Kelly Jones storyline. I just picked it up because it was cheap and it was Batman. And I like Batman, I like The Dark Knight, and his adventures. Gotham City, I'm always up for it. Always up for it. Poison Ivy being in the cover. This also gives you an ad for the, I think it's called Amalgam Universe or something, the DC Marvel crossover with Spider-Man and Batman, and it says also Kingpin and Ra's al Ghul. We're gonna be in it, probably the antagonists, probably. Well, I think this collects also two issues, seems like. I barely checked it out, but it's Batman, and Batman's great. So, nothing more to say about this. Magnificent. So, then, on to our next thing. How am I gonna handle this? Just right away. Start with the second volume of Hellboy. But before, I guess it's going to become a running gag, I'm going to take a sip of water. That made some weird noise, you've probably recognized. But now I'm hydrated. and into the game again, back in the game. Hellboy, Volume 2, Library Edition Volume 2, it's great. One of the best, in terms of production value, it's one of the best editions that you can ever find out there. The library editions of Dark Horse are always a treat, but those specifically are. It's really special. They collect two volumes, although in this case it doesn't really matter because it's mostly short stories. Anyway, these are just rather significant ones. And Hellboy really, you know, I personally got to know it, or got in touch with it through Guillermo del Toro's movies. Which really differ from the source material. But I personally think that this is even better, which I wouldn't have thought. I always got this recommended and never really jumped on the train, but eventually I did. And fabric cloth material here with golden letters on the spine, beautifully done, probably the best you can think. It's even better than the rest of the library editions from Dark Horse, for example. Here, The Goon, just for instance. where to begin? It's kind of hard wrapping things up. Great art here. Really thick paper stock, feels good, a great binding. And the printing's pretty good, bright colors, although the colors technically aren't bright, but what I wanted to say is that it's glossy paper. And as we wear with the colors, we're just gonna, you know, talk about the art now, some sort of analysis. I actually took down some notes to remember what I was trying to say. I have some of them here, but I guess I'm just going to say it right away. The cars are really decentered. You know, only Hellboy, the red protagonist, you know, this bright red, it really stands out. Unlike his other pals, like, for example, Abe Sapien. Of course, he is a pale fish guy, but still, you know, Hellboy really stands out from the rest. Mike Mignola often uses shadows and black achromatic colors to, in this case not a color, but to make shading and to show, it's just his art style. And it really differs from the most things I've seen, which is also why I found it, from an artistic perspective, of course, I find it special, unique, cool, in a way, really a capable artist. Nobody came close to what he did, and everything else was a copycat, and you could clearly recognize, but still, it took a while until I got used to it, especially since I hadn't expected this from a Hellboy comic, what I was previously seen on the movies, really turned out to be something totally new. Yeah. Now I have to take a look at what I've written down the color gradients. The color gradients, or at least if there's going on any gradation, it's very rare. You only see, like, that doesn't really depict it well. Maybe I can find a better example. Mm-hmm. For shading, he uses black, but there's a bit of shading also going on between actual colors, with one slightly going into the other, so really smooth shading, and really rare here, as you can see in this not sunrise, what's the opposite? I don't know. I have a blackout. But you know what I mean, the sky. He has a very angular and etchy style, sort of art style, as you can see. His characters always look like that. That's also what makes him special. Some backgrounds are often just monochromic, or monochromic and then somehow with black added. But I gotta say, I like that in a way. And sometimes it's really square-like depictions, kind of. And he often waves or doesn't apply any outer lines, any contours. That's also what makes it special. Not always, but sometimes. In the back, we get some sketches, and we see where he took his inspiration from. Really get some notes and some approaches of his. That is great. Different character workouts and beta versions, I guess. The prototypes, and just where we are at inspiration now, and it's clear where he took inspirations from. He really manages it to put in things like religion and mythology, mythological creatures, also things from other cultures, and this is what he really accomplished in such a well way. I've never seen it being that good in a comic, I think. That's what really makes him stand out, and the content is often, you know, in this particular one, we get to learn something about Hellboy's parents, for example. There are short stories, it's full of short stories and narratives like pancakes, about hell by eating pancakes for the first time, and then the hell is all going crazy because he enjoyed it. Pretty funny. Those are small details that really makes this special, in a way. Great. I think, yeah. Wait a moment. We also learn Rasputin, the movie antagonist, or we get further into his character that we know from the first movie with Ron Perlman. Yeah. And Pancakes also appeared in 1999's Dark Horse Presents Annual. Funny story. So this is really a feast for the eye. I definitely recommend you check it out. And please, for all the German viewers, kauft euch nicht die Crosscut Edition, denn die tun's einfach nicht. Das ist so viel besser hier. So viel. Das ist einfach das Geld so viel mehr wert. Da gibt's, glaube ich, kaum eine Debatte drüber. Aber gut. Jetzt bin ich ins Deutsche abgeschweift. Let's continue with English. On to our last topic for today. Those are freebies from the free comic book day, because this exists in Germany too, but it's done differently. We get different issues. Also German ones, for example, like Werner. I picked up 6 out of, I have no idea how many there were. I wasn't there on the free comic book day. I was actually there 1 week later. I forgot that it was, and I also forgot the word I was looking for, desperately looking for. Zip. Onyx. Everything gulping down. I haven't read Werner. It's really something I couldn't really explain to an English audience. It's crazy, but this one really lives from its dialect, and that's simply that's the charm. You cannot understand it otherwise. It couldn't be translated or so. I do not know the new comics. I haven't tried them out in a while, but they honestly, it really seems to be very different from the originals, with a lot of splash panels. I might also be wrong. I'm gonna check it out anyway. Then. Austrian Superheroes might be the counterpart, is the counterpart to Liga der Deutschen Helden, League of German Heroes, that I also don't know, but yeah, now there is Austrian Superheroes team up. I find the idea funny and cool in a way, innovative. Kind of reminds me, of course, of Jörg Butgereit's Captain Berlin. Maybe some of you might know that, but I doubt it from the American or English audience. Alright, and then there's Kultgeschichten, just some stories, one of them done or drawn by Sascha Derb, also a colleague or fella that me and my parents know, who's also probably gonna be on the comics album. I'm gonna talk about that anyway. Later, I haven't checked it out either, maybe in the next